Bon dia, president del Consell Social, rector, doctor Pasqual.
El buscava, no sé ben d'estar.
Padrí de cerimònia, el doctor Àlex Pomerol. Vicerrectors, vicerrectores, degans, deganes, caps de departament i d'instituts de recerca, professors, investigadors, estudiants, personal de l'administració i serveis, amics i amigues. Avui ens congreguem aquí per portar a terme una de les accions més importants d'aquesta universitat des del punt de vista d'honors, que és el nomenament d'honoris causa de la doctora Lisa Randall. I sense més us dono la benvinguda i anem a començar aquest acte. Constitueixo aquest claustre avui dia 25 de març de 2019 per tal d'investir doctora honoris causa la senyora Lisa Randall i demano al doctor Rafael Rebollo, secretari general d'aquesta universitat, i al doctor Àlex Pomerol, padrí de la nova doctora, que la vagin a cercar. Us demano que us aixequeu. Benvinguda, doctora Lisa Randall. Es declara oberta la sessió. Dono la paraula al secretari general, doctor Rafael Rebollo, que llegirà l'acte de nomenament de doctora honoris causa a favor de la senyora Lisa Randall.
Benvolguda rectora magnífica de la Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona, benvolgut rector Pasqual, benvolgut president del Consell Social, benvolgut degà de la Facultat de Ciències, benvolgudes deganes i degans, directores i directors, professores i professors, benvolguts membres de la comunitat universitària. És un honor, com a secretari general d'aquesta universitat, llegir l'acte de nomenament com a doctora honoris causa de la doctora Lisa Randall. Acord 44-2018, aprovat a la sessió del Consell de Govern de 3 de maig del mateix any. Vista la proposta de l'equip de govern, pel qual es sol·licita al Consell, en commemoració del 50è aniversari de la Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona, el nomenament de la doctora, dels doctors honoris causa. Atès que la normativa d'aquesta universitat per l'otorgament del títol de doctor honoris causa, aprovada pel Consell de Govern en data 26 de maig de 2004, estableix en els seus articles 4 i 5 una sèrie de requisits a considerar pel mateix Consell per poder otorgar aquesta màxima distinció e incorporar a la candidata a la nostra comunitat. Ateses les circumstàncies excepcionals referents a la commemoració del 50è aniversari de la Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona, la rectora, a proposta de l'equip de govern, presenta al Consell aquesta proposta de nomenament com a doctora honoris causa. A la vista de les consideracions anteriors, el Consell de Govern adopta l'acord següent: nomenar a la doctora Lisa Randall doctora honoris causa de la Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona, per les seves investigacions i pels seus estudis, com a professora de física de les universitats de Princeton i de Harvard, que ha relacionat el seu àmbit d'estudi amb el camp humanístic. La doctora Randall és especialista en física de partícules i cosmologia i una pensadora marcadament transversal que ha sabut relacionar els coneixements del seu camp amb els de la filosofia i la música. Enhorabona.
Dono la paraula al doctor Àlex Pomerol, padrí de la nova doctora, perquè faci la lauda, la de la laudatio de la pròxima doctora.
Benvinguda rectora, autoritats acadèmiques, professors i alumnes. És un plaer ser el padrí de la professora Lisa Randall, una persona que ha destacat per les seves contribucions al camp de la física de partícules. Les teories proposades per la professora Lisa Randall han aportat solucions als problemes més importants dins de la física de partícules i han inspirat una àmplia gamma de cerques experimentals, especialment el gran col·lisionador de partícules LHC, el CERN, a Ginebra. Tot això, l'interès de la professora Lisa Randall s'ha extès més enllà de la recerca puntera i també s'ha centrat a transmetre aquest coneixement al públic en general. Això ho ha fet possible no sols gràcies als seus llibres de divulgació, sinó també mantenint una estreta col·laboració amb artistes en un intent per trobar camins per portar al públic les idees científiques. Professor Lisa Randall was born in Queens, New York. And already at the early stages of her life, she showed a talent for science. She was admitted at the Hampshire College Summer Studies in Mathematics, an American residential program for mathematically talented high school students. And at the age of 18, she was winner of the Westinghouse Science Talent Search. Professor Randall was admitted at Harvard University, where she studied physics and earned a Bachelor of Arts in 1983. She decided afterwards to pursue the PhD in theoretical particle physics under the supervision of Professor Howard Georgi, at that time one of the most active researchers of particle physics and one of the first to propose the unification of forces. After Harvard, she joined the University of California at Berkeley as a postdoctoral fellow, where she stayed for 3 years. At that time, this is around 1990, there were already several indirect indications that the Higgs particle could exist. This was thanks in part by the work of Lisa Randall and Michael Golden that showed that any alternative to the Higgs boson would lead to modification of the properties of the Z boson, the particle mediating the Higgs force, that had not been observed. Nevertheless, the possible existence of the Higgs particle also had its own problems. In order for the Higgs to be light, having a mass of 100 giga electron volts or 200 giga electron volts, it would require an amazing adjustment or fine-tuning of the parameters of the model. Similar as we had to adjust the temperature of this room with more than 15 digits of precision in order not to die of cold or heat. This was indicating how limited and unnatural were theories for elementary particles with a Higgs, a fact that motivated the search for better models. It was probably a good challenge for Professor Lisa Randall that decided to move her research towards understanding theories that could explain the smallness of the Higgs mass in a natural way, without adjusting a huge number of parameters. She started studying theories with extrasymmetries, what is called supersymmetry, and wrote several articles that had a very impact in the community. Professor Lisa Randall joined the MIT faculty in 1991 as an assistant professor, receiving the tenure in 1997. A year later, she got a joint appointment at Princeton and MIT as a full professor. It was about that time when Professor Lisa Randall, together with Professor Raman Sundrum, wrote two seminal articles where they proposed the revolutionary idea that the smallness of the Higgs mass had to do with the existence of an extra dimension. They proposed that the Higgs could reside inside this extra dimension, and as a consequence, its mass, or energy, would be much smaller than the mass of the other particles. This soon received the name of Randall-Sundrum models. This extra dimension, of course, could not be as large as our three spatial dimensions, but it should be tiny, said that it could have escaped present detections. In fact, Professor Randall and Sundrum predicted that to see the extra dimension, we would need high energy collisions, as energetic as the one at the present Large Hadron Colliders at CERN. Today, the search for this extra dimension is one of the main motivations for present and future particle accelerators. These two articles of Professor Randall and Sundrum created a big impact in the scientific community and are already today among the most cited articles in particle physics, having collected more than 15,000 citations. Also for this work, Professor Randall and Sundrum received this year the prestigious Sakurai Prize for the theoretical particle physics given by the American Physical Society. Professor Lisa Randall moved to Harvard as a full professor in 2001, being the first female theoretical physicist to obtain this position. She has received a numerous number of awards and honors for her scientific contribution. For example, she's a member of the National Academy of Science, the American Philosophical Society, the American Academy of Arts and Science. She's also an honorary member of the Royal Irish Academy and an honorary fellow of the British Institute of Physics. Professor Lisa Randall has also received many prizes and awards, such as the Tomassoni Award from the University of Rome, Kolbtec Award from the American Society of Physics Teachers, Julius Lilienfeld Prize of the American Physical Society, and the Julius West Prize, among many others. But the interest of Professor Lisa Randall, as we said, has also centered into transmitting and sharing her passion for science to the general public. With this purpose, she has written many articles in newspaper and magazine, and she has appeared many times in the TV and radio. She has also written several books for the general public. Okay, I can mention two of them: War Passages, Unraveling the Mysteries of the Universe, Hidden Dimensions, and Knocking on Heaven's Door, How Physics and Scientific Thinking Illuminate the Universe and the Modern World. Both were selected for the New York Times list of 100 notable books. Professor Lisa Randall has also pursued the intertwining of art and science as a means to transmit knowledge. She has participated in many art exhibits and performances all over the world. In particular, I would like to single out the libretto that she wrote for the opera Hyper Music Prologue, a projective opera in seven planes, composed by the Catalan Héctor Parra, that was performed in El Gran Teatre del Liceu in 2009. La professora Lisa Randall és una vella coneguda dels físics de partícules de Barcelona. Molts de nosaltres hem tingut la sort d'interaccionar amb ella en múltiples ocasions, sigui en congressos internacionals o les seves estades a Barcelona. Actualment forma part del Comitè Científic Extern de l'Institut de Física d'Altes Energies. A part, el seu anhel per connectar art i ciència també l'ha portat moltes vegades aquí a Barcelona a participar en actes a l'Art Santa Mònica, al CCCB o converses en l'òpera. També, és curiós, va ser seleccionada entre un dels 12 participants del Somni, una òpera en 12 plats, un banquet en 12 actes, realitzada per el celler de Can Roca, juntament amb altres artistes coneguts com Ferran Adrià, Miquel Barceló o el director d'òpera Josep Pons, entre d'altres. Repassant l'extensió i impacte del treball de la professora Lisa Randall, on pot comprendre per què va estar a la llista de les 100 persones més influents del 2007, segons la revista Times. És per això que tinc el plaer, l'honor i el privilegi de demanar a la rectora magnífica de la Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona que otorgui el grau de doctor honoris causa a la professora Lisa Randall.
Doctora Lisa Randall, heu estat designada doctora honoris causa pel Consell de Govern de la Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona i com a símbol us lliuraré un diploma i us imposaré la medalla de doctora honoris causa. Us admeto i us incorporo al claustre de professorat de la Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona. seu... La doctora Elisa Randall pren la paraula per fer-nos la seva classe magistral.
I'll just start speaking. Okay, good. Can we get it? Okay, there we go. Very good. So first of all, I want to say thank you. Thank you to everyone here. It's really a pleasure to be speaking here today and receiving this honorary degree. This university I've been to before, it's really a wonderful place, and I very much appreciate my colleagues here and in Barcelona. And I also appreciate very much the attention to science and to culture that I've found on my many visits here. It's really a wonderful thing. So thank you again. Today, I will be speaking about some research that I've been doing. I don't know if you're ready for a physics talk, but since this is for knowledge, I guess it's good that I tell you some knowledge. So I'll share some knowledge with you. And it's... based on some ideas that I've been working on about dark matter, and I'll tell you about what that is. And also, these ideas can be found in the book Dark Matter and the Dinosaurs, which is translated. And also, I just want to send a shout out to my wonderful publisher in Spanish, which is Acantillado. So the book is also in Spanish. So let me just begin. And I just want to mention, though, that why I think physics and communicating physics is important. It's certainly not true that everyone needs to understand every detail of every idea, but I think it is important to recognize that although some of the ideas we work on seem very abstract and foreign, they do connect to the concrete realities of our world, and that was one of the things I wanted to get across in writing this book and in some ways in this research. And also, I think it was just important for us to understand the history of the universe and the solar system and the planet and even life on Earth when we think about how quickly things are changing here today in this universe, in this world that we live in. But let me just start by telling you about the makeup of our universe, which I thought everyone knows, but my close friend who's here said he didn't even know this till yesterday when I mentioned it. So I'll mention it for all of you now. This picture is sometimes called the cosmic pie. It tells us what the energy of the universe is made of. And one thing you can notice is that a very small slice, the white one, is atoms. It's the stuff that we're made of. The stuff that we're made of is only 5% of the energy of the universe. About five times more than that in terms of energy is something called dark matter, which I'll tell you more about. But just briefly, dark matter is matter in the sense that it acts gravitationally like ordinary matter. It clumps together into galaxies, for example. But it doesn't interact with light the way our matter does. It doesn't experience any of the standard model forces that we know of. It only experiences gravity, as far as we know. So dark matter has been observed in many different ways. I'll outline a few of them. We can't see it the way we see ordinary matter. So it's not made up of ordinary stuff. It's not made up of atoms. It really is something quite different. In addition to that, there's something called dark energy. Dark energy is about 70% of the energy of the universe. We know about dark energy because it accelerates the expansion of the universe. The expansion of the universe is actually accelerating. And something called dark energy accounts for that. Dark energy is very different. Dark energy is something that's sort of smoothly spread throughout the universe. It doesn't clump into things the way ordinary matter does. Thank you. And we've measured these various components, and we'd like to understand what they are. And one thing that I actually find striking about this pie is, as a dessert eater, any of these pieces of pie would be rather satisfying. If I ate dark energy, it would probably be too much. Ordinary matter, maybe a little bit too little, but all of them are substantial, which is to say all of these are about the same size. I mean, one might be four times bigger than the other, but they're all roughly comparable. I mean, in principle, the amount of dark energy could have been 10 trillion times more than the amount of ordinary matter, or 10 trillion times less. The fact that they're all comparable, I think, is an intriguing fact. So as I said, dark matter is something that interacts via gravity, that has very little, or if maybe no other interactions through standard model forces, like electromagnetism. In some ways, it's not really surprising that it should exist. A lot of people question whether or not dark matter exists, but really there's no reason that all matter should be like ordinary matter. In fact, I find it kind of amazing that we're as much of the energy of the universe as we are, after all. We're just the part of the universe that we experience and can observe. In fact, it could be that billions of dark matter particles, you might ask where it is, well, it's really all around us. And in fact, billions of dark matter particles might be passing through you every second. But you wouldn't know it because the only interaction might be gravity. And if that's true, the interaction is so small that you just wouldn't experience it. So it could be passing through, we wouldn't even know it. So how do we see dark matter? Why do we think it exists? So I'm going to just give you a very quick rundown. Obviously, this is not going to be a very long talk, so I won't give you in great detail. If you want the details, you can read my book. Just to give you a sense of why we know dark matter exists. The way it was sort of discovered, really sort of established, was through something Vera Rubin and other colleagues did, which is to measure something called galactic rotation curves. And that's in our galaxy, the Milky Way galaxy, stars rotate. And they rotate around in a way that reflects how much matter is in the universe. Excuse me, just one second. Give me a second here. No, you're just going to get stuck. Don't do that. Okay, there we go. Okay, there's the watch. Get stuck. So it reflects how much matter is in the universe. And so if you measure the rotation rate of stars, you find that it can't be accounted for by the visible matter. There was an indication just by looking at the rotation of stars that there had to be more matter that held it in. If that matter didn't exist, the stars would just fly outside the galaxy, which clearly wasn't happening. So that was an indication there was matter there that wasn't being observed. It wasn't emitting light. Similarly, if you look at galaxy clusters, which are groups of galaxies that are gravitationally bound, they also were moved, the galaxies in these gravitational clusters move faster than can be accounted for by the visible light. Again, an indication that there was matter that no one was seeing. There's something called gravitational lensing, and I'll quickly show you a slide after this, and I'll tell you more about that. And also something called the Bullitt cluster, and I'll have a slide on that as well. So I'll skip those. The expansion of the supernova that were observed that told us about the acceleration of the expansion of the universe also tell us about dark matter, because you have to establish both one before you can deduce the existence of the other. There's also the cosmic microwave background radiation. It turns out that there's very detailed structure embedded in the radiation left over from the time of the Big Bang that tells us how matter contracted and expanded at the time that these photons were imprinted on the sky. That tells us about dark matter. But a couple of things that I find quite remarkable and are just the very existence of galaxies in the lifetime of the universe. The very fact that we have the structure that we call a galaxy wouldn't exist without dark matter. Structure could really only begin to collapse after the energy and matter dominated over the energy and radiation, which was redshifting away, which was losing energy and becoming smaller. And had there only been ordinary matter, there wouldn't have been enough time for structure to form and collapse the way it did. So there really had to be this extra matter. So even without any of those other things, just knowing that the galaxies were formed in the lifetime of the universe was an indication that dark matter existed. And in addition to that, the structure on the scale of the Milky Way, if there had not been dark matter, if all matter interacted with radiation, structure on the size of the scale of the Milky Way would have been wiped out. So also the fact that there's something the size of the Milky Way is also an indication of dark matter. So even without those detailed measurements, knowing the lifetime of the universe and knowing the size of our galaxy is enough of an indication that dark matter exists. But I promised I would tell you just a little bit about gravitational lensing in the Bullitt cluster. And I like these because they sort of really show us a little bit where how dark matter is distributed in the universe and how it works and that it really is matter. So what's going on in this slide is that, I don't know if this works, but I try it. Ah, there we go. Okay. So even though dark matter doesn't emit light, you could have some other object behind that emits light, some object that does. Now, it might be that the light from this object passes by some other object, like a galaxy, for example, that could contain visible matter, but it could contain dark matter. It doesn't matter, because we're just looking at its gravitational influence. And in response to that matter, the light will bend. We know that from Einstein's theory of general relativity, how to calculate how light bends in the presence of other matter. But the way that it bends will depend on the direction it took when it's going past this galaxy. In this picture, it might be deflected down, it might be deflected up. So the consequence of that is that when we see this object from here on Earth, where we're looking, we might see multiple images of the same object, because we think light came to us in straight lines. So we might see either multiple images or just a spread out image, which is called gravitational lensing, which is an indication that there was matter in between this object and us. And if it cannot be accounted for by the visible light, then it's clearly the presence of dark matter. So what I like about this is it's a way it can be useful in sort of tracing dark matter throughout the galaxy. And another thing, a question that's often asked is, how do you know it's really dark matter? How do you know you just didn't get your equations wrong? Well, the first thing I'm going to say in response to that is that changing the equations is a lot more radical than thinking that there's dark matter. Thinking that there's matter that we haven't seen, when we know for a fact that we didn't have the ability to see it, is not a very big assumption. I mean, since we know that it doesn't emit light or emits very little light, it's not surprising we wouldn't have seen it. So the existence of dark matter, there's no reason it shouldn't be there. As I said, I don't see any reason why all matter should be like our matter. But changing Einstein's theory of general relativity is a very radical thing to do. We've tested it very well. So that's a very hard thing to do. But in addition to that, even changing those equations, it's very hard to explain things like this. It'd be very hard to explain this thing called the Bullitt cluster. As I said earlier, a cluster of galaxies is a gravitationally bound set of galaxies. And what you see here is that it looks like it was formed by the merging of other clusters of galaxies. And what is in pink is sort of gas, and what's in blue is dark matter. So when you observe this object, you see that there's gas that sort of gets stuck in the middle because of the interactions of gas. There are other interactions. Whereas dark matter, which is relatively weakly interacting, just passes through. And this is exactly what you would expect from something which is dark matter. It would be very hard to modify the equations of gravity to account for this type of behavior. So I just want to say that at this point, I would say dark matter is not speculation. We really know it exists. We don't see it with our eyes directly, but we've observed many gravitational influences. And moreover, there's a consistency among these gravitational influences. They require the same amount of dark matter. So it really is an entirely consistent scenario. You can also ask where it is. As I said, it's around us. But what we also know about dark matter is that it's in a roughly spherical halo in our Milky Way. So our Milky Way, one of the great things about Barcelona, which I've talked to many people about, is that it's near so many beautiful places. And some of these places you can get away from the lights of the city. And when you do, you will see the Milky Way. And you'll see this beautiful strip of light in the sky. Now you can ask, why is it a strip of light? Why is it a Milky Way disk? Dark matter is in a halo, roughly spherical, but ordinary matter is more or less in this disk of the Milky Way. And the reason for that is that ordinary matter does interact via other forces, such as electromagnetism. And because of that, it can radiate. It can radiate away energy. So it radiates away energy, it cools down, and it collapses into this Milky Way disk. Skip that. So we know dark matter exists. We've had many observations of its gravitational consequences. But we don't know at a fundamental level what it is. Is it a particle? If it is, what is the mass of the particle? Does it interact via anything other than gravity with standard model particles? Does it interact with itself? Is it even a single particle, or is it more than one particle? We don't know the answer to any of these questions, and those are the kinds of things we as particle physicists are trying to answer. Can we find out more about the nature of this dark matter? So the motivation for the research is that we know it exists, but we want to know what it is. And so what I do, what my colleague Alex Pomerol does, what many of the people here do, is something called model building. We want to think about what the options are for what can underlie what we see. We've made observations, we understand the standard model, but we want to know what goes beyond it. And in this case, we want to know what it is that could constitute dark matter. So what model building is sort of a way of characterizing the possibilities. It's different ways of thinking about the problems, and also sometimes it gives rise to different observational tests. So different ways to experimentally or observationally test whether these ideas are correct. And one thing that's pretty funny is, you know, I think in a lot of the times of science, people act very confidently when they work on something. They know what they're doing is right. With model builders, we're not necessarily quite so attached to what we write down. We care a lot. We work out all the consequences. But we know for a fact that we don't yet know whether it's right or not. What we're thinking of ways that we can go out and test these ideas. So they could be ruled out by experiments. They could be identified by experiments. But we're interested in both of these things. One popular candidate for dark matter that I mentioned just because probably many of you have heard about it is known as a WIMP, which is a WIMP weakly interacting mass of particle. And for many people, it's their favorite possibility. The idea behind WIMPs was that maybe, although dark matter is separate, maybe it is somehow connected to the standard model. It's clearly not made up of atoms, but maybe it appears in something, some theory that's already existing for physics beyond the standard model. After all, if there is a particle that's stable, that is to say it doesn't decay into other particles, it lasts forever, but it has about the same mass as the Higgs boson, then you can calculate over the thermal history of the universe how much of it should exist today, and you find out that the amount of dark matter, if it is this thing, is roughly the same as would be required by the observational, by the observations that have been made. And whether it's precisely the same depends on the details. But just doing the simple estimate of how much energy would be stored in dark matter, you find that if a particle has about the same mass as the Higgs boson, it would be a suitable candidate for dark matter, which means that, which got very many people excited about this possibility. The other thing that makes it exciting from the point of view of experiments and observations is that if this is true, maybe it is somehow connected to the standard model. So even though it doesn't interact a lot through standard model forces, maybe there's a small interaction. And with that small interaction, we would have a chance of discovering it. And so the way people have looked for dark matter is threefold. There's three different ways people have looked. And so I just wanted to clarify, though, when people say they've been looking for dark matter, they've really been looking for WIMPs. Because if you don't have these small interactions with the standard model, you won't see this dark the dark matter. So when people say we haven't discovered dark matter, so dark matter doesn't exist, that's not true. We haven't discovered WIMPs yet. And so WIMPs might not be the answer. But the way people have looked for WIMPs is through these small interactions with the standard model. So one possibility, which is illustrated here, is known as direct detection. And the idea is to have something deep underground, and deep underground to shield from cosmic rays. It could be either in a tunnel or a mine. And there's a big dark matter detector, and it's big because the interactions are small. So you're only going to find something if it's big enough that even though any individual probability of interaction is small, there's a lot of chances. I think in Italy, there's the Gran Sasso mine where people look for dark matter. And so that's one possibility. And as I said, they've looked a lot. We haven't found it yet. Another possibility is known as indirect detection, which is dark matter can meet another dark matter particle. and turn into standard model particles, which of course have the advantage that they're particles that we can actually detect because they do interact with our detectors. So if you have dark matter turns into ordinary matter, and in particular if it turns into things that we wouldn't see from ordinary astrophysical processes, that would be another indication that dark matter exists. And I should say that during these searches, people have found deviations from what was expected, but in fairness, it's usually because the astrophysicists made predictions that were not correct or that needed to be modified. So we haven't discovered dark matter that way yet either. And the final possibility that you might hear about is looking for dark matter at the Large Hadron Collider. And that has to do, again, with if dark matter is roughly the mass of the Higgs boson, maybe it's accessible at the Large Hadron Collider. But again, we haven't yet found it. So I think that possibility is getting a lot less likely. So the question that I and my collaborators asked is, what if WIMPs is not the answer, and we don't find dark matter through any of these methods? Basically, the WIMP parameter space will be fully explored within the decade. And if that's we don't find a WIMP, does that mean we'll never know anything about dark matter? And so what we'd like to say is no, but it's definitely speculative, the idea. So we're thinking maybe dark matter is something else, just like WIMPs were speculation. We're going to make a different speculation, which is the idea that maybe dark matter interacts with itself. And if it does interact with itself, we would have a chance of finding it. We would have a chance of finding at least the structure that would be formed because of these interactions. Again, we wouldn't see it directly because it's not interacting directly with us. Maybe it has interactions that we don't experience, just like we have interactions dark matter doesn't experience, but there could be some consequences. And as I'll try to argue, it could affect the solar system, and this will be eventually where this elusive connection to the dinosaurs will come about, really the extinction of the dinosaurs. Okay, so the basic insight is pretty simple. Why should ordinary matter be the only type that's special? Why should we have the only type of matter that has interactions? We know a lot about the standard model particles. We know, first of all, the different forces, and we also know there are different types of particles. So maybe that's also true for dark matter. And it is funny, though, because every time you make a suggestion like that, every time we repeat the Copernican revolution, we find out we're not the center of the universe, our matter isn't the center of the universe, there's other structure. People are very shocked and horrified, even though each time we learn the same lesson over and over again. So it seems like by now we should have an open mind and be willing to entertain this possibility. So as I said, I'm going to be talking about matter that interacts with itself. It's called self-interacting dark matter. And so we're going to assume that dark matter interacts, but only with itself, so that conventional search constraints don't apply. And in particular, we're going to ask the question whether, just like ordinary matter experiences electromagnetism, maybe dark matter experiences its own form of electromagnetism, which you might jokingly call dark light. Something that ordinary matter doesn't experience, but dark matter does, and ask whether we would see the consequences. And in this case, we're actually not even going to assume that all the dark matter experiences this force. We're going to suggest that only some small part of the matter experiences this force. Now, you might say, why would you care? We haven't even seen all of the dark matter. Why would we care about a small fraction? But I remind you that ordinary matter is only a small fraction, 1/6 of the matter of the universe. Yet we care a lot about it. That's, of course, because we're made up of it, but because we're made up of it and we care about it because it has interactions that allow us to see it. So if there's a small fraction of dark matter that has interactions, maybe it too will be the most obvious and most detectable part of dark matter, even if it's a small fraction. So the simple idea is that it is just dark light, just like we have a proton, electron, and a photon. Maybe there's something similar in the dark matter sector. So there's a dark matter particle, a light dark matter particle, and a dark photon. And it would have, as we showed, significant consequences, consequences that give rise to observable effects. In particular, just like I explained to you that ordinary matter forms the Milky Way disk because it radiates, dark matter would do the same thing. So you could form a dark matter disk. And the interesting thing is that if dark matter is heavier than a proton, that disk would be likely to be thinner and denser than the ordinary matter disk. So there would be a thin, dense, dark matter disk within the Milky Way plane, if this idea is right. And that's pretty exciting, because right now, you could tell whether or not that exists through the motion of stars as detected by the Gaia satellite. The Gaia satellite was launched by the European Space Agency. It's measuring a billion stars in the Milky Way. It's measuring their position and velocity very precisely. And with that information, you can deduce whether or not this dark matter disk exists. It turns out that it's a little bit trickier than we thought originally, because if the stars that you're studying are not in equilibrium, it's harder to tell whether or not that disk exists. So right now, there's some controversial results. I mean, there are some Gaia results, but it's not yet clear whether they really fully establish the existence or non-existence of this dark matter disk. But there can be other consequences, and that's, so now I'll just briefly tell you why this could be connected to the extinction of the dinosaurs. But that's going to require me to change gears for a few minutes. And one of the reasons I like giving this talk in terms of the knowledge theme is that one of the things about this research and the research that it's based on is that it really did tie together many different fields of science, not just physics. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about our solar system for a few minutes. And so the solar system, as you know, has the sun and now what we now think of as 8 planets. But in addition to those planets, there's other objects that are moving, such as the asteroids in the asteroid belt and comets, objects that will become comets that are in what's called the Kuiper belt. Actually, it's some small relative of the Kuiper belt called the scattered disk, which gives rise to the short-period comets. And short-period comets are comets that come around with a period less than 200 years, every 200 years. There really are more objects, but it would have been too complicated a picture to draw all of them. But one of the exciting developments of the last, I don't know, say 50 years, is understanding that there's all these other interesting things in the solar system other than just the planets, all these smaller or regular objects. Comets are the icy objects that are in the outer parts of the solar system. This one is just beyond Neptune that could eventually come close to the sun. And when they come close to the sun, they give rise to the gaseous emissions that tell us that, that give rise to the tail, which is how we identify comets. But in addition to the scattered disk and the Kuiper belt, there's something called the Oort cloud, which is thousands of times farther away from the sun than the Earth. That's really far away. And it's so distant that things that orbit there are relatively weakly bound gravitationally to the sun, which means that even if there was a small kick to one of those objects, it could be thrown out of the solar system or be more likely to come hurtling towards the inner part of the solar system. So out there in the Oort cloud are these objects that are relatively unstable, but so that if there's a kick, their orbits might be destabilized. And it turns out that this really happens. Some stuff hits. Now, not all of it comes from the Oort cloud. A lot of the time, it's just asteroids, nearby objects hitting. This is a beautiful example called the Meteor Barringer Crater in Arizona in the United States. It's probably the best preserved what's called an impact crater, a crater formed not from a volcano, but really from an object hitting the Earth. And the whole history of the story of understanding that objects really do hit the Earth is rather amusing. And the study of this one in particular was also rather funny. And I'm not going to tell you all of it, but I will tell you that, you know, people who worked out in the field, you know, farmers or peasants, were pretty aware that stuff hit the Earth because sometimes they saw it. They were outside and they saw the stuff hit. And the scientific community and the more intellectual community kind of laughed at them and thought, you know, sure, stuff is hitting the Earth. And in fairness, you know, they also thought a lot of things that weren't true. But then eventually something hit right in front of the Academy of Science in Siena, which convinced the scientists that this idea was actually correct. And from that time on, they knew that stuff hit the Earth, but it wasn't clear. It's, you know, you had to identify how these impact craters are formed and what they are. And so there were a lot of incorrect ideas, and then eventually it was understood. But now, here is a list. I mean, you could look up on the internet. And here is a list of craters greater than 20 kilometers across. And we picked 20 kilometers because that's formed by an object that's at least a kilometer big. So there are craters that are bigger than 20 kilometers across from the last 250 million years. And there's roughly 25 of them. So that had been found. Now, clearly many more things have hit the Earth. After all, most stuff falls in the ocean because there's more surface area of ocean. And stuff that even if it falls on Earth, it's not clear that we're going to preserve it forever. But these are the ones, or even that we'll find them all, or that we would know it even if we did find it. But there's about 25 of them. So there's not huge statistics, but that's a lot of big stuff that's hit the Earth over that we've actually found. Now, why do we care about this list? Well, suppose our idea is right and there is a dark disk. This comes back to the idea that even if there was a small kick, these things in the Oort cloud could be destabilized. And so the idea is that the solar system, we know that the solar system goes around the galaxy every about 250 million years. And as it does so, it actually bobs up and down through the plane of the Milky Way. If there is actually this dark matter disk, that could happen with about the 30 or 35 million year periodicity that you can observe in that list of craters I showed you. And also, it could happen sort of episodically because it's only happening roughly when it's going through the dark disk. So it would sort of explain features we've observed. Does that mean it's absolutely correct? No. But it was kind of a fun possibility that's worth testing. And we know the properties of the dark matter disk that would be required to do this. And so we're checking whether or not that dark matter disk does exist. So again, the idea is that you would find these happening on a periodic basis. And interestingly enough, the last one that killed the dinosaurs, that created the last major mass extinction, I should say, happened 66 million years ago. So just to remind you, or maybe tell you, in the Phanerozoic Eon, which is sort of the last 250 million years when there were sort of hard fossils being formed, bones, et cetera, not just bones, but other things, we know of 5 major mass extinctions. I mean, everyone knows about Darwinian evolution, things evolving slowly. Mass extinctions are times when things change really dramatically on the surface of the Earth, with like 2/3 or 3/4 of the life species on Earth disappearing, and also leaving no descendants, so really just disappearing from the record. And the last major extinction happened 66 million years ago, where 2/3 of the species on the planet disappeared. But one of them was the dinosaurs, which is why it's related to the extinction of the dinosaurs. And it was studied quite a lot because that happened fairly recently. People wanted to know what happened. There was strong evidence in the geological record. You could see white rock that was representative of various fossils that were there, then a thin layer of red clay, and then above it, it was gray rock. And this was all over the globe. And that indicated that those fossils disappeared and species went extinct. These objects called forams no longer were around. This was found all over the globe. Actually, one of the first places this was studied was actually in Italy, where Walter Alvarez did some work. Eventually, through various reasoning that I'm not going to go through, but that combined together many different fields of science again, geology, chemistry, nuclear physics. It was all put together, and it was understood that there was a big object that hit the Earth. The story of how the crater was found is interesting, too. It turns out the crater associated with this extinction is in the Yucatan. And it was found to something of the right size and the right time. And when I say right time, it's now been measured to within, I think, 20 or 30,000 years, which is quite accurate for something that happened 66 million years ago. So there's definitely this crater associated with this extinction. And possibly that crater is associated with dark matter. So I'm just going to leave it there. This is just in Spain. You can also see this rock up in the north, not too far from Bilbao, where I happened to be visiting, giving a physics lecture. And one of the physicists who had a cousin who was a geologist there said, oh, do you know, I mean, they didn't even know I was working on this. And they said, do you know you could see this layer, this what's called the KPG layer nearby. So we went on a little outing. And this is someone in charge of the park area. the scientist in charge of that. So we're looking at it. And if that's not enough reason to go there, it's really beautiful. And there's actually a lot of geological history that's stored there. So I just want to say that this isn't the only possible connection. I talk about a lot of different connections. I'm not going to go through all of them here. But maybe the fact that we're here today is because large mammals emerged only after dinosaurs were eliminated, and maybe that's connected to dark matter. And just to, in the theme of knowledge, I just want to say that there were four major lessons that I had when I was writing this book. And one is just really how amazing it all is. Some of these features really are remarkable. And another was, as I pointed out before, all the fields of science that came together in understanding these extinctions, for example. But the other thing that's really striking is how recent we've understood so much of this. You know, a lot of the time people want to understand things like, why don't we know about this? But we've really developed a comprehensive understanding of cosmology, for example, and particle physics only in the last century. But the same is true for other fields, which are really only now coming into their own. It's really quite remarkable how fast science is advancing. And in general, the rate of change is really an important guidepost when we're studying these changes. For example, as I said, with the history of life, some people were thinking of it all as slow evolution, like Darwin. But then there was also this idea of extinction that Cuvier promoted. So really, both of these things are very important. And I think it's important to think about how quickly we're changing things on Earth in the context of how slowly things evolved to the point we got to today. So I don't know if the dark disk is right. The search for it is ongoing as you speak. But I do know there are amazing connections in the universe and ultimately to life. So this is the book. And this is just a fun slide that I like to show because some of you might be familiar with the Big Bang Theory. And I had some friends who were writers. And so when I was visiting them, they said, why don't you just be an extra? And I'm a very good actor, it turns out, because my directions were to sit in the lunchroom and be inconspicuous. And apparently I was so inconspicuous that most people didn't even realize I was in this picture, even though I'm clearly right there. And I like to say that because when we think about model building, part of the point is that you often don't find things unless you know what to look for. And this is a pretty obvious one. Now imagine that you're looking for these details in the universe. So hopefully by developing models and looking for things, we'll discover a lot more. So again, thank you very much for this honor, and I hope you enjoyed this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, doctora Randall. I ara donarem pas a l'actuació musical que farà el nostre cor com és habitual.
The song we are going to sing was written by Pere Vallvé, the conductor of this choir, who unfortunately cannot be here today with us. But anyways, he was based, well, this song is based in some of your aphorisms, and so it was written specially for this occasion, and we hope you enjoy it. It's called Secret of Cosmos.
We els uns als altres per comprendre'ns. Teixim més que tenir, cavar, covard, sembrar noves preguntes a les cendres, trobar-nos per cercar. Mai no tenir la prou en informar-nos, voler traspassar els límits i crear, conèixer més que créixer i explicar-nos, cridats a transformar. Amapes a tot, llevar-nos d'hora, tirar per camins nous, el pas canviant per fer-lo més de tots.
De la doctora Randall. Gràcies. Bé, una vegada més, president del Consell Social, rector doctor Pasqual, doctora Lisa Randall, padrí de la cerimònia, doctor Àlex Pomerol, vicerrectors i vicerrectores, degans de ganes, caps de departament i molts instituts de recerca que avui ens acompanyen, professors i professores, investigadors i investigadores, estudiants, personal de l'administració i serveis, amics i amigues. En primer lloc, vull dir més fort, perquè ja l'he dit personalment, congratulations, doctora Randall, em sento molt honorada d'incorporar-vos al claustre de professors de la Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona. Avui acabem d'investir com a doctora honoris causa a una dona, física teòrica, experta en física de partícules i cosmologia, que com molt bé ha lloat el seu padrí, el doctor Pomerol, i també ella ens ha demostrat amb la lliçó magistral que acaba de dictar, que estic convençuda que ha sigut fàcil i entenedor per tots nosaltres, crec que podem felicitar-nos de l'encert del Consell de Govern en prendre la decisió d'atorgar-li el màxim reconeixement de la nostra universitat, que és aquest doctorat honoris causa. Jo, que tinc pocs coneixements en la matèria en la que ella és una autoritat internacional, i per tant, jo no podria dir res més adient respecte a la seva vàlua per obtenir aquest nomenament del que el seu padrí ens ha descrit. Sí que voldria destacar alguns aspectes que la fan més, si es pot, mereixedora d'aquest honor. Com també ens ha assenyalat el doctor Pomerol, la doctora Randall ha estat capaç de desenvolupar un gran treball de transferència del seu complex coneixement en aquells professionals que treballen en matèries de l'esfera de la física de partícules i cosmologia, i això, com ja sabeu, entra en el pla del que és habitual entre col·legues de les àrees de coneixement. Però ella, al mateix temps, ha fet quelcom de particular, que no és freqüent entre els científics. Ha estat capaç d'acostar la física teòrica al ciutadà que, com jo, no tenim formació acadèmica en aquesta especialitat. La seva feina en aquest àmbit de divulgar el coneixement científic ha estat i és una seva constant aportació. Participa de forma habitual en els mitjans de comunicació, ràdio, televisió, diaris, revistes, etc. I ha escrit diversos llibres que, en fer la seva lectura, ens permeten caminar amb facilitat per un camí enrevessat que ens porta a través de les hipòtesis, les equacions, el llenguatge matemàtic, les tecnologies, la llum i la foscor o la matèria fosca, sense perdre'ns. I us ho garanteixo perquè, preparant això, he llegit alguns trossos dels seus llibres aquests dies, que es podeu trobar de forma lliure a internet. I gaudint, sense perdre'ns, i gaudint de cada espectacle científic com si passegéssim per un bosc un dia de primavera o de tardor, on els colors i els sorolls ens aporten sensacions de repòs i benestar. I això que és la matèria fosca, i que per tant et fa cert respecte i certa por. Llibres com Llamando a las puertas del cielo, Universos ocultos, o La matèria oscura i los dinosaurios, de la que avui ens n'ha parlat, són treballs on la doctora Randall desvela pistes i descobriments de la física des de les observacions fetes per científics del segle passat fins a la física de partícules del segle XXI, desenredant amb seducció els misteris dels mons que poden existir just al costat del nostre. Aquest món en el que vivim i que més o menys coneixem, i com deia una ressenya del diari El Mundo parlant d'ella i del llibre Universos Ocultos, Lisa Randall construye un viaje fascinante por las dimensiones extras del universo apelando a una relación de filigrana poblada d'exemples de la vida quotidiana. O com diu ella en la introducció del seu llibre La matèria fosca i els dinosauris. El libro resume, això és el que diu ella, el libro resume nuestro conocimiento actual sobre el universo, la Vía Láctea y el sistema solar, así como lo que condujo a que surgiera una zona habitable y la vida en la Tierra. Hablaré sobre la materia oscura y el cosmos, pero también sobre los cometas, los asteroides y la aparición y extinción de la vida, con especial atención al objeto que cayó en la Tierra y que mató a los dinosaurios y buena parte del resto de las formas de vida. En aquell llibre parla del cataclisme que va fer desaparèixer els dinosaures, fent referències a la vida política, al medi ambient, a la cultura pop i al rock, a les relacions entre les coses visibles i les que es troben en l'obscuritat, o del paper del llenguatge escrit i l'empremta en l'adquisició del coneixement en confrontació al pes que ha tingut internet. Totes aquestes aportacions ens permeten acostar-nos més fàcilment a la llum i a la foscor d'aquesta ciència complicada que és la de física de les partícules i la cosmologia. Gràcies, Lisa, per ajudar-nos a comprendre millor fenòmens complicats. També la doctora Randall ha estat capaç de relacionar la recerca amb la música i les humanitats i, sense cap dubte, ens dona una idea del que és i com veu el món aquesta dona. Estem front una científica que compta amb una bona motxilla de lletres i, per tant, estic segura que és una dona flexible, oberta, creativa i que des d'aquesta visió del món és capaç de trencar barreres, obrint nous camins en la ciència i en les relacions socials, sent un motor de canvi en l'educació, el coneixement i en l'evolució de les nostres societats. Fa temps que estic convençuda que el software cultural no pot funcionar sense el hard biològic. Per tant, els humanistes no poden aprofundir en temes com la ètica, les estructures de poder, les religions, les desigualtats de gènere, sense tenir en compte la perspectiva evolutiva del món, de l'univers o del cervell. O els científics no poden prescindir dels aspectes culturals, educatius, de les societats humanes on es desenvolupen els fenòmens biològics, físics i bioquímics. Per tant, crec que és un valor i un honor el poder comptar en el nostre equip amb una científica humanísticament ben informada i formada. Gràcies, Linda, per haver acceptat formar part d'aquesta comunitat i espero que el teu exemple ens inspiri a fer avenços perquè la nostra docència, recerca i transferència compagini les humanitats, les ciències sociològiques, les ciències experimentals i de la salut i les tecnologies, i que això ens permeti facilitar la formació de ciutadans oberts, crítics, ètics, creadors i professionalment competents. De nou, moltes felicitats. Congratulations, doctora Randa. I ara, com és habitual, acabarem aquest acte amb el nostre Gaudeamus Igitur. Per tant, dret, sisplau. Donem per clos aquest acte i podem passar a prendre una copa de cava.